Good morning, everyone. Welcome to Calvary Chapel, Ellicott City. We'll begin in the book of 1 John this morning. 1 John, if you want to turn there in your Bible. Book of 1 John, chapter 4. 1 John, chapter 4. And if you would, please stand while we read the Word of God together. 1 John chapter 4, beginning in verse 7. Beloved, let us love one another, for love is of God, and everyone who loves is born of God and knows God. He who does not love does not know God, for God is love. In this, the love of God was manifested toward us, that God has sent his only begotten Son into the world that we might live through him. And this is love, not that we loved God, but that he loved us and sent his Son to be the propitiation for our sins. Beloved, if God so loved us, we also ought to love one another. No one has seen God at any time. And if we love one another, God abides in us, and his love has been perfected in us. By this we know that we abide in him, and he in us, because he has given us of his Spirit. And we have seen and testify that the Father has sent the Son as Savior of the world. Whoever confesses that Jesus is the Son of God, God abides in him, and he in God. And we have known and believed the love that God has for us. God is love. And he who abides in love abides in God, and God in him. Love has been perfected among us in this, that we may have boldness in the day of judgment, because as he is, so are we in this world. There is no fear. There is no fear in love, but perfect love casts out fear, because fear involves torment. But he who fears has not been made perfect in love. And we love him because he first loved us. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for the blessing to gather with you this morning, Lord. And we gather in the name of Jesus Christ, Lord, the name of no other name, Lord. So we thank you for being here with us, Lord, and all the places where we gather throughout this area, Lord, throughout this nation that we love so much, this nation that you bless, Lord. And Father God, we just ask for the presence of your Holy Spirit with us this morning, Lord, as our worship. As our worship rises from all these different locations, Lord, we pray that you would just gather it all as one, Lord, and that it would be pleasing to you. And mostly, Lord, we just pray for the presence of your Holy Spirit to be with Pastor Dan this morning, Lord. As we make our way through this book of Genesis, Lord. A book that we love, but the world questions, Lord. And we just pray that you just make a way, Lord, for your word. So Pastor Dan speaks it this morning into the hearts and minds of all of us, Lord, to whoever's listening this morning, Lord. And that your love would be so clearly shown, Lord. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Blessed assurance. Beautiful name, it is the name of Jesus. could separate us now. What a wonderful name it is. What a wonderful name it is. The name of Jesus Christ, my King. What a wonderful name it is. Nothing compares to this. What a wonderful name. my heart and all that is within. I lay it all down for the sake of you, my King. I'm giving you my dreams. I'm laying down my rights. I'm giving up my pride for the promise of a new life. And I surrender all to you, all to you. And I surrender all to you. This song, waiting at the cross, and all the world holds dear, I count it all as loss, for the sake of knowing you, the glory of your name, to know the lasting joy, even sharing in your to you, all to you. And I surrender all to you, all to you.
Amen. Well, good morning, church family. It's good to be with you again this Sunday morning. So glad you're here. So glad you're tuning in and that you're being intentional about continuing to seek the Lord, continuing to worship together with our church family. Before we get into our study this morning, I want to share just a couple of announcements with you, some information for you. Coming up this Thursday night, we're going to begin a study of the book of Ezekiel. Thursday night, starting at 7 o'clock, online, of course, we'll begin looking at the book of Ezekiel, a wonderful prophetic book that I think you'll really enjoy studying together. Also, Monday, Wednesday, and Friday nights at 7 o'clock, my wife, Cameron, and I are having a discussion online, just a brief 10 to 15-minute discussion, looking at the prison epistles of the Apostle Paul. In a series that we've entitled Lessons for the Lockdown, just some things that we can glean from the letters of Paul during his imprisonment that we can apply to our current circumstances. So you can check that out Monday, Wednesday, Friday, 7 o'clock on Facebook or on our YouTube channel. And then just as another reminder, we have children's ministry content for you available on our website. You can go there, you can print out the lessons for your children. There are video lessons on there for your kids to watch so that they can continue to receive the content they would receive if they were here in person. So be sure to check out our website for that. All right, we're going to be in Genesis chapter 4 this morning. Genesis chapter 4, if you want to turn there in your Bible for me. Genesis chapter 4. So we are going verse by verse through the book of Genesis on Sunday mornings currently. Genesis chapter 4, and if you will, if you'll stand with me as we read the word of God for us this morning. Genesis chapter 4, it says in verse 1, "Now Adam knew Eve, his wife, and she conceived and bore Cain, and said, I have acquired a man from the Lord. Then she bore again, this time his brother Abel. Now Abel was a keeper of sheep, but Cain was a tiller of the ground. And in the process of time it came to pass that Cain brought an offering of the fruit of the ground to the Lord. Abel also brought of the firstborn of his flock and of the fat. And the Lord respected Abel and his offering, but he did not respect Cain and his offering. And Cain was very angry, and his countenance fell. And so the Lord said to Cain, why are you angry? And why has your countenance fallen? If you do well, will you not be accepted? And if you do not do well, sin lies at the door, and its desire is for you, but you should rule over it. Now Cain talked with Abel, his brother, and it came to pass when they were in the field that Cain rose up against Abel, his brother, and killed him. Then the Lord said to Cain, where is Abel, your brother? And he said, I do not know. Am I my brother's keeper? And he said, what have you done? The voice of your brother's blood cries out to me from the ground. So now you are cursed from the earth, which has opened up its mouth to receive your brother's blood from your hand. When you till the ground, it shall no longer yield its strength to you. A fugitive and a vagabond you shall be on the earth. And Cain said to the Lord, my punishment is greater than I can bear. Surely you have driven me out this day from the face of the ground. I shall be hidden from your face. I shall be a fugitive and a vagabond on the earth. And it will happen that anyone who finds me will kill me. And the Lord said to him, therefore, whoever kills Cain, vengeance shall be taken on him sevenfold. And the Lord set a mark on Cain, lest anyone finding him should kill him. And then Cain went out from the presence of the Lord and dwelt in the land of Nod on the east of Eden. And Lord, we thank you for your word today. Lord, as always, we ask that your Holy Spirit would be our teacher. We ask, Lord, that your Holy Spirit would open our eyes and our ears and our hearts to your word this morning. I pray, Lord, and ask that your Spirit would be upon me to teach your word this morning. And we pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. You may be seated. Well, in chapter 3, we saw the fall of man and the consequences of the fall of man. And chapter 3 ended with the expulsion of Adam and Eve from the garden. As part of the consequence of their sin, they could no longer dwell in the garden, in the presence of God, which reminds us that our sin separates us from God. And so they were put out of the garden. And the language in chapter 3 indicates that God had to force them out of the garden. Understandably, they didn't want to leave. They wanted to stay in the garden with God. They didn't want to leave. I read a story recently about a young newlywed couple who is on their honeymoon in the Maldives Islands in the Indian Ocean. This beautiful resort island, they're staying in this luxury resort, and 4 days into their honeymoon on this island at this resort, the airports in South Africa where they were from began to shut down due to the coronavirus. So now they are stranded in this luxury resort on an exotic island in the middle of the Indian Ocean. And they've been there throughout the shutdown for the coronavirus. And they're spending their days on the beach and snorkeling and eating in the restaurants there at the resort. They're the only two guests left at this resort. So they have the whole resort to themselves. Now, if I were them, I wouldn't want the quarantine to end. I wouldn't want to have to leave such a beautiful location. Well, for Adam and Eve, they didn't want to leave paradise with God. They didn't want to leave the garden, and God had to force them to go. And so now life begins outside of the garden for Adam and Eve, and chapter 4 focuses on the children of Adam and Eve, in particular their first child, Cain. And one of the things we see here in chapter 4 is that Adam and Eve's sin nature was passed on to their children. Romans 5:12 tells us that sin and death entered the world through Adam, and it spread to everyone, to all of mankind, even to this day. Verse 1 begins with the birth of Cain, the first human baby born in the world. It says, Adam knew Eve, his wife, meaning intimately, and she conceived. And she bore Cain and said, I have acquired a man from the Lord. And one thing I want you to think about here is that Eve was the first woman to go through a pregnancy and to go through labor and to go through delivery. No one had ever experienced this before. She didn't have her mother to counsel her or any girlfriends that could counsel her about pregnancy and labor and delivery. She had no one she could ask advice from or ask questions. There was no doctor or nurse she could talk to. There were no books she could read about pregnancy, books like What to Expect When You're Expecting. She couldn't Google anything. There was no WebMD, none of that. And it's really amazing when you think about what Eve went through in having this first child. And when their son Cain was born, notice that Adam and Eve acknowledged the child was from the Lord. It was not just the result of biology, but Cain was given to them by the Lord. And they acknowledged that in their response. You know, Psalm 127 says, children are a gift from the Lord. They are a reward from Him. Every human life is a gift from God. Every human life has a purpose and value to God. Every life is fearfully and wonderfully made by Him. And so they have their first child, Cain, and they name him Cain, which means acquired. And they named him Cain because he was acquired from the Lord, we're told. And the name here, it seems to imply that Adam and Eve believed that this son was the promised seed of Genesis 3:15. God said He would give them a son, a child, the seed of the woman that will crush the head of the serpent. And it seems here, the way that they named Cain, that they believed Cain was that promised seed, that promised son. It's as if, you know, here he is. I've got this son that God promised that will crush the head of the serpent. I've acquired the son. Here's the son that's going to restore everything back to the way it was. But as we're going to see in this chapter, Cain was not the savior that they were hoping for. In fact, he's far from it. You know, we get the saying, raising Cain, from this chapter, from Genesis chapter 4. It's talking about Cain in the Bible. So they have their first child. They name him Cain, which means acquired. They've acquired a man from the Lord. Verse 2 says, then she bore again, this time his brother Abel. Now Abel was a keeper of sheep, but Cain was a tiller of the ground. So they have a second son. They name their second son Abel, which means breath. Elsewhere, this word is translated vanity or vapor. It's used in the book of Ecclesiastes over 38 times to describe the meaninglessness of life apart from God. So Cain's name reminds us that life comes from God. Abel's name reminds us that life is brief and meaningless apart from God. And we're told again in verse 2 that Abel was a keeper of sheep, but Cain was a tiller of the ground. So Abel was a shepherd. At this point, mankind did not eat meat, and so they raised sheep for milk. They raised sheep for wool, for clothing, and they raised sheep for sacrifice as an act of worship. We're told that Cain was a tiller of the field. He was a farmer. Verse 3. Now look at verse 3. It says, in the process of time, it came to pass that Cain brought an offering of the fruit of the ground to the Lord. Abel also brought of the first fruit of his flock and of the fat. And the Lord respected Abel and his offering, but he did not respect Cain and his offering. Now, I'm just going to go Bible nerd on you for a few moments here. In verse 3, when it says, in the process of time, it came to pass. That phrase means that it was a designated time. It was at a designated time, which gives us some insight here. That tells us that already at this point in human history, there were designated times to make an offering to God. This was not the first time sacrifices were offered to God, or the first time ever for Cain to make an offering to God. This was a regular thing on the calendar. What's different about this time is Cain, this time, offered an unacceptable offering. Previously, Cain's offerings were acceptable to God. This time, he decided not to offer an acceptable offering. Again, in verse 3, in the process of time, at this designated time when they would regularly bring their offerings to God, in the process of time it came to pass that Cain brought an offering of the fruit of the ground to the Lord. Abel also brought of the firstborn of his flock and of their fat, and the Lord respected Abel and his offering, but he did not respect Cain and his offering. So they both bring an offering. Abel brings the first of his flock. Cain brings some of the fruit of the field. If you remember back in chapter 3, God clothed Adam and Eve with the skins of animals, showing us that the shedding of blood from a substitutionary sacrifice is the only acceptable offering to God. Cain's offering was a bloodless offering, and so it was unacceptable. Abel's offering was according to the way God prescribed. It was a blood sacrifice, and so the Lord respected Abel because of Abel's offering that he brought. Cain's offering, and this is important, Cain's offering shows us that we can't just come to God any way that we want to come. We can't be accepted by God on our own terms. A popular view today is that all roads lead to God, and you can approach God any way you want, or through any religion you want, or no religion at all, that all paths are equal and all paths are acceptable to God, and that's not true. If it were true, then Cain's offering would have been accepted. God is the one who sets the terms of how we approach Him, not us. And we can come to God only through the way He provides, and only through the way He accepts. And God has provided us with one way that is acceptable, and that's through Jesus Christ. Jesus said, "I am the way, the truth, and the life, and no one comes to the Father but through me." Jesus is the one way. Jesus is the only way to the Father. He's the only sacrifice that God will accept. In Hebrews chapter 9, verse 22, it says, "Without the shedding of blood, our sins cannot be forgiven." God requires the shedding of blood for the forgiveness of our sins. It's always been that way, all the way back to the garden, all the way back to Adam and Eve, and it hasn't changed. The sacrifice of Jesus Christ on the cross is the only acceptable sacrifice to God. It's the only sacrifice that gives us access to God, that He receives and He respects. Verse 5 says that Cain became angry and his countenance fell because God did not respect his offering. Now, in the New Testament, if you're a note taker, in the New Testament, in the book of Jude, in Jude verse 11, because there's only one chapter, Jude verse 11, it mentions the way of Cain. The way of Cain. The way of Cain is rejecting God's way and then becoming angry when God does not accept your way. That's the way of Cain. Rejecting God's way and becoming angry when God does not accept your way. Cain became angry that God rejected his offering, even though it wasn't the offering that God asked for. He becomes angry, and in verse 6 and 7, God responds to Cain's anger. So the Lord said to Cain, "Why are you angry? Why has your countenance fallen? If you do well, will you not be accepted?" God says, if you do well, will you not be accepted? Meaning Cain could still offer the proper sacrifice and be accepted. You know, at any point, a person can put their faith in Jesus Christ and be accepted by God. The door of salvation is always open for us. The Bible says, whoever calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. And look at what God says here about Cain's sin. In verse 7, he says, "And if you do not do well, sin lies at the door, and its desire is for you, but you should rule over it." By the way, this is the first time the word sin appears in the Bible. And remember, this is the first person born in the world after Adam and Eve are created. You know, this is just the first generation here. And here he talks about sin. He says, sin lies at the door and its desire is for you. And God describes Cain's sin as like a wild animal waiting to pounce and devour Cain. And when God says its desire is for you, that means sin wants to rule over you. Sin wants to control you. Sin wants to dominate you. And that's still true today. Our sin nature wants to control us. Our sin nature wants to rule over us and dominate us. But the cross of Jesus Christ breaks the power and dominion of sin over our lives, and it sets us free. Listen to this verse out of Romans chapter 6, verse 6. "We know that our old sinful selves were crucified with Christ so that sin might lose its power in our lives. We are no longer slaves to sin." Amen to that. Because of the cross, we are no longer slaves to our sin. We no longer are dominated with a life of sin. Our sin no longer controls us. We've been set free from the power of sin, the dominance of sin. So now that brings us to verse 8, where we have the first human death in history and the first murder in history. You know, for Adam and Eve, you think about them, their hope is in their son Cain, that this is the one that God has sent, the seed of the woman, to deliver us, to restore back to us everything we lost. And their hope was in Cain. And he turns out to be a murderer. And he murders their other son, their second son. Verse 8 begins by saying, "Now Cain talked with Abel, his brother." And the wording here in Hebrew, it means that Cain lured his brother out into the field, away from the public eye. If you have, I think the NIV, the New Living Translation, you get kind of a sense of that in the way that those translations are worded. So he talks to his brother to convince his brother to go out into the field with him. So this is a premeditated murder. This isn't just that, you know, Cain was emotional or lost control of his anger and unintentionally killed his brother. This was planned. Cain was angry that his offering was rejected, and his anger grew into envy for his brother, because Abel's offering was accepted by God. And Cain became envious of his brother, and angry with his brother, and got to the point where he wanted to kill his brother. He was so envious of him. You know, anger is a very powerful emotion. Envy is a very powerful emotion, and it can lead to very dangerous behavior, even leading to murder. Now, that's why the Apostle Paul tells us, don't let the sun go down on your anger. Don't let a single day pass where you're harboring this anger or this envy or this bitterness or this resentment in your heart. Don't let the sun go down. Deal with it immediately. In other words, don't give it an opportunity to take root in your heart. Be quick to confess your anger to God. Be quick to confess your envy to God. Be quick to forgive others and be reconciled with them if possible. Some relationships you really can't be reconciled with the person because of just a lot of reasons. But be quick to forgive them, even if you can't be reconciled to them. Do everything you can to deal with your anger, deal with your envy, deal with your bitterness. That's the sin nature that God was warning Cain about, that it was crouching at the door, ready to dominate you. This envy, this bitterness, it's right there. It's ready to dominate your life. The longer you wait to deal with it, the harder it will become to overcome it. It will get rooted in your heart. It'll be difficult to pull it out and remove it. So Cain talked with Abel, his brother, and it came to pass when they were in the field that Cain rose up against Abel, his brother, and killed him. Again, we have the first murder in all of human history. Then the Lord said to Cain, "Where is Abel, your brother?" And the Lord asked Cain, "Where is Abel, your brother?" And of course, God knew the answer to this question. He was asking Cain to give Cain the opportunity to confess his sin. He was giving Cain the opportunity to get it in the light and confess his sins. God is always giving us opportunities to confess our sin, giving us opportunities to get our sin into the light. The Bible says if we confess our sins, he's faithful and he's just to forgive us of all of our sins and to cleanse us of all of our unrighteousness. And he presents Cain here with an opportunity to do that. Look at Cain's answer in verse 9. He said, "I don't know." That's the first lie in the Bible. "I don't know. Am I my brother's keeper?" This is the first human lie in the Bible, I should say. The first lie, of course, was by Satan in the garden when he said, "You will not surely die." So this is the first human lie. So Cain was a murderer, and Cain was a liar. You know, Jesus said the children of the devil are murderers and liars because Satan was a murderer and liar from the beginning. Cain was a child of the devil because he was a murderer and a liar. This is also the first human question asked in the Bible. Am I my brother's keeper? He says, I don't know. Am I my brother's keeper? Can you hear the tone of defiance in Cain's answer, his question, his insolence toward God? It's like Cain was saying to God, "I don't answer to you. I don't answer to you." There's a defiant tone in the way that Cain is speaking to God. "I don't know. Am I my brother's keeper?" You know, for those of you that are parents, you wouldn't let your child speak to you like that, would you? You would say, "Excuse me? Who are you speaking to like that?" And so Cain has this defiance in his answer, this insolence in in his answer. In verse 10, God said, "What have you done? The voice of your brother's blood cries out to me from the ground. So now you are cursed from the earth, which has opened its mouth to receive your brother's blood from your hand. When you till the ground, it shall no longer yield its strength to you. A fugitive and a vagabond you shall be on the earth." Now, remember, Cain was a farmer, but as part of his punishment now, remember, God gave him the opportunity to confess his sin. He passed it up, and he's defiant in the face of God here. "I don't know. Why are you asking me? I don't have to answer you. Am I my brother's keeper?" And so now, as part of his punishment, he loses his green thumb, so to speak, here. The ground will no longer yield crops for him. No matter how hard he works, it's not gonna produce anything. You know, the Bible says that the way of the transgressor is hard. You know, when you transgress against the Lord, it's an act of defiance. It's when God makes a line and says, "Don't cross this line," and we defiantly cross the line. It's a transgression. The way of the transgressor is hard. It just leads to a hard life and difficulty in life. Life became hard for Cain because of his transgression and his defiance. Also, as part of Cain's punishment, it says he was to be a fugitive and a vagabond on the earth. Now, a vagabond is someone who has no home. A fugitive is someone who is running from home. A pilgrim is someone who is heading to home. Those of us who have trusted Jesus Christ are pilgrims, the Bible says. We are headed home. We're on our way home to heaven. Our hearts, the Bible says, are set on pilgrimage. Our hearts are set on home. And each day, we're one day closer to getting home. Because of his choices, Cain was not a pilgrim. He's not headed home. He's a vagabond and a fugitive. He's running from home. He has no home now on the earth. He's just wandering the earth. He's alienated from his family. He never feels at home. He never feels at peace. He has no destination that he's heading to. He's just wandering through life. What Cain has done through his defiance of the Lord is he has created for himself a pretty intolerable life. Pretty intolerable life. And I think that this describes what life is like for many people who choose to just defy God and go their own way, go the way of Cain. It leads to a hard life and an intolerable life in many ways. In contrast, Jesus Christ gives you a home. He gives you a family. He gives you peace. He gives you direction for your life. And ultimately, he gives you a destination. You're going to heaven. Now notice Cain's response in verse 13 to this consequence. And Cain said to the Lord, "My punishment is greater than I can bear. Surely you have driven me out this day from the face of the ground. I shall be hidden from your face. I shall be a fugitive and a vagabond on the earth. And it will happen that anyone who finds me will kill me." It's ironic that Cain is worried about getting killed here, considering he's a murderer. His response here says a lot about Cain. Cain was only concerned with the severity of his punishment and how it would affect his life. There's no hint that he felt guilt over his actions. He didn't say, "My guilt is too much for me to bear." He didn't say, "My sin is too much for me to bear. What can I do about my sin? How can I get relieved from the guilt and the shame I feel over my sin?" No, he said, "My punishment is more than I can bear." In other words, Cain does not regret his actions. He regrets the consequences to his actions. And he's not willing to repent. He's not willing to turn to God for forgiveness and for a remedy and for a way out of this. This is the way of Cain. This is the way of Cain. Someone who just defies God, shakes their fist at God, is angry with God, goes their own way, and they're angry about the consequences of their choice. They resent the consequences they've brought on their own lives. You probably know people who have made a mess of their life. They've burned all their bridges. They've made a mess of their family, and they hate the consequences of their choice, and maybe they're miserable in their circumstances, but they're not willing to humbly turn to God and ask God to forgive them. They're not willing to call upon the name of the Lord for salvation. No matter how miserable their life is, they're still going to defy, still go their own way. That was Cain. That's the way of Cain. Now look at verse 15. And so the Lord said to Cain, "Therefore, whoever kills Cain, vengeance shall be taken on him sevenfold." And the Lord set a mark on Cain, lest anyone finding him should kill him. Now, this verse tells us that there were other people in existence on the earth, which prompts the question, well, where are these other people? Who are these people that he's worried about that will kill him? I mean, at this point, isn't there just Adam and Eve, Cain and Abel? He killed Abel, so who's going to kill Cain? Well, over in chapter 5, verse 4, we're told that Adam and Eve had many other sons and daughters. And so Adam and Eve had other children. Those children had children and so on. And so there's other people on the earth. And Cain is concerned that someone will kill him as he's now a fugitive and a vagabond on the earth. And so what God does now in verse 15 is God places a mark on Cain to protect him. Now, we aren't sure what exactly this mark was that God placed on Cain. There's a lot of conjecture out there in the commentaries about what this mark was. We don't know if it was some kind of visible mark, that, you know, like "do not kill" written on his head. I don't know. Or if it was an invisible mark of some kind. It just says God put a mark on Cain. Now, there are occasions elsewhere in the Bible where God places a mark on a person or on people. We see it in the book of Ezekiel. We see it in Revelation chapter 7 with the 144,000 Jews. God placed his mark on their foreheads during the tribulation. God will place his mark on their foreheads during the tribulation period. Whatever this was, whatever kind of mark it was, God placed his protective seal on Cain so that no one would harm him. Now you might be thinking, why would God do this? Cain's a murderer. Cain's a liar. Cain's defying God. Cain's insolent. Why would God spare a murderer like Cain? The reason is, listen, is because God is merciful and God is gracious. That's just who he is. That's just his nature. And you know what? In his mercy, God did not give us what we deserve. And by his grace, God gives us what we don't deserve because he's merciful. And he's gracious. And by the way, this wasn't the end of the story for Cain. It's not that Cain got away with murder. The Bible says it is appointed unto man once to die, and then comes the judgment. Cain will die. And Cain will stand before God. And God will be his judge. God will have the final word with every person. So that brings us down to verse 16. It says, "Then Cain went out from the presence of the Lord. Now, that indicates that the Lord was still in the Garden of Eden, that he was still in a geographic location on the earth. Cain leaves from there. Remember, they're outside the garden. He leaves out from the presence. He goes out from the presence of the Lord. Now, watch what he does. Verse 16, and he dwelt in the land of Nod on the east of Eden. Now, we'll get to it next week as we continue this study. But God told Cain that he would wander the earth as a vagabond and as a fugitive. So what did Cain do? He goes out from the presence of God. He goes to an area known as Nod, and we're going to see next week, he's going to build a city there. He's going to build a city. It's just another act of defiance against God. God says, I'm going to be a wanderer. I'm going to be a fugitive. I'm going to wander the earth. No, I'm not. I'm going to build a city. See, this is the way of Cain. This is the way of Cain. Cain defies God over and over. He's not willing to come under God's authority. He's not willing to obey God in any way. It's just one act of defiance against God after another. This is the way of Cain. And as we'll see next week, this is the way of Cain's family. This is his legacy. You see it in his descendants, just this act of defiance. Instead of submitting to God, obeying God, walking in his ways, honoring God, and doing things the way God wants us to do. And Lord, we thank you for your word today. We thank you for the bad example of Cain. Lord, of what it looks like of a person who just lives in defiance to you. Lord, help us to just take the warning of Cain and the way of Cain and how it leads to hardship and separation and misery. Lord, we thank you that we can come to you anytime we sin. We thank you that we can come to you anytime we blow it, no matter how badly we blow it, that you're always willing to forgive us. You're always willing to cleanse us by your blood. We thank you, Jesus, that you are the offering that is acceptable to God, and that through your death, burial, and resurrection, that we have a way now that we can come to God and be accepted by him. And we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's stand together and close with our benediction.
Spirit of the living God, fall afresh on me. Spirit of the living God, fall afresh on me and melt me, mold me, fill me, and use me. Spirit of the living God, fall afresh on me.
Hey, if you're watching today, you need prayer for anything at all, please contact us through our website. You can email us through our website, calvaryec.com. If you are listening and you've never trusted Jesus Christ, you've never put your faith in him and his death and resurrection, Jesus is the acceptable offering. He is the only way to God, and no one comes to the Father but through him. You can't come to the Father any other way. He hasn't provided another way. You have to come to God on his terms, and his terms are through faith in Jesus Christ. So if you haven't done that, you should do that today. Right where you are, just pray and ask God to forgive you of your sins and ask Jesus Christ to come into your life and be your Lord and be your Savior. Thank Him for dying on the cross for you. And if you do that, I want you to contact us and let us know. We want to follow up with you, pray with you, encourage you in that. So please go to our website, calvaryec.com, email us, let us know if you've prayed to receive Christ or rededicated your life to Christ, or if you need any prayer needs at all that we can help you with. Let us know. May the Lord bless you. May the Lord keep you. May He cause His face to shine upon you. May He be gracious to you this week and give you peace. In Jesus' name, amen. God bless you guys.